Okay, it's great to be online and show you some stuff again. I've got Jeff Sanders over here from America, so he's well, actually Europe now.
Well, Spain for part of the time, and yeah.
So I thought it'd be a great opportunity just to grab everything we have out of the shed here and just talk about hackamores, bosals, bridles, snavels, just the tradition from the California bridle horse, I guess.
Yeah.
So just start. Got some different equipment.
We'll go through just a couple quick things on definitions. The macate, when we talk about the macate, that's the hair rope that ends up making the reins with our hackamore and our bozal. When we look at some of the definitions, the difference between what we consider a hackamore and what we consider a bozal in the old tradition, if it's big enough to ride by itself, then it's considered a hackamore. If it's small enough that you ride it under the bridle with the bit and this at the same time, then it's considered a bozal. There's different definitions in different traditions in the U.S., but on the central coast of California, where I was born and raised and where all of this originally comes from, that's kind of the definition we use for that. And when we look at these, all the gear is made out of natural materials, and it doesn't matter where it was made. This one was made in California. This one was made in Germany. This one was made in Australia. And they're all good functional hackamores, all made out of natural materials. But the key for any hackamore or bozal is that it has to have a rawhide core that then gives it the life that it needs to be very usable as a good signaling device for the horse.
Right. What about, you know, common bozals that are on the market that people should steer away from?
These. These are like a typical eBay kind of hackamore. If you look really closely in here, there's actually a steel cable in this thing, and it's practically a club. It has no life. You can't move it. It's super stiff. Now this one's smaller. The braiding on this one is actually not that bad, but again, the core is steel. So not only does it not have the same kind of signal, but you can't shape it properly to fit the face of the horse, so then you're going to run into all kinds of problems with its use. And that's one of the big problems I see, is that people buy these things off of eBay and those kind of places, and they don't work. So then they say, well, the tool doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Well, it's actually the poor quality tool.
How would they tell, just as a quick look, from the average person that has no idea?
You have to either buy it from somebody that you know is a reputable seller, or you have to pick it up and actually handle it. So one of the things that I look for, like this one that made by Mischenug in Germany, it's got to flex this way, and it's got to have a wave that goes through it. And it goes all the way through the entire nose button with the wave. And then if you fold it, it should snap back. That way we know we get a good clean signal. If it doesn't snap back, then we get kind of a dead signal where you pick up the rein and this part moves, but the nose doesn't, and we lose the quality. The other is that if you look at this, you can clearly see that this follows the contour of the horse's face. And we can see where, you know, it should be have a little bit of use in there, a little bit of dirt and, you know, sweat. And we can see where that contact has been all the way through the whole face, which is exactly what we want. Because anywhere we lose contact, we lose signal.
Yeah, maybe we'll talk about fit in a minute. So. And then there's so much information out there, isn't it? You get on YouTube nowadays, Facebook, there's so much information.
And everybody on the internet is an expert, so, you know, we got to kind of watch out for some of that.
We do. You know, some of the people that put themselves out of authorities, I guess, on the subject, they say you start with 1 inch and then you, you know, go down to 3/4. And
yeah, for me, the sizing, if I was only able to own one tool to ride a horse in the rest of my life, it would be one good 5/8 hackamore. When I start a young colt, I've got a 4-year-old that I'm starting right now. Mm-hmm. I'll start him in a 3/4 inch, which is one size up from this.
Yeah.
And I'll ride him in that for a little while. It may be a few days, maybe a couple weeks. But basically, once I've got right, left, forward, back, and he's responding good and he's soft and he's relaxed, then I'll go ahead and switch to the 5/8, and he will be in that until it's time for him to start thinking about going to the 2-rein and the bridle. And really, technically, you don't even have to do that. You could stay in this for the horse's whole life if you choose to. And that's one of the many myths out there, is that you can only stay in the hackamore for a short period of time, and it's actually not true. My uncle, who was an old vaquero in California back in the 40s, 50s, he would keep some horses. They'd be in the hackamore. They'd be 25 years old and still be riding in the hackamore.
So you'd say, what is the style of riding that gets them to be heavy?
Yeah, it is. It's a lot of people ride the hackamore thinking that they can ride it with the same methods that they use with other tools like snaffle bit. And it's a different tool. When you ride it in the old way, you can stay in it the horse's whole life. And I was kind of taught that those people who say you have to transition to the hackamore because the horse gets heavy in it, so you need to go to the bit, well, if they're maybe missing something. Because if you made the horse heavy in the hackamore, if you ride this horse the same way in the bridle, why do we think they're going to be light?
It's almost saying he's not ready for the bridle, isn't
he? He isn't. If he's heavy in the hackamore, then we need to go back and fix something. He's not ready.
Okay, so you start in 5/8 and then the same Makati?
Yeah, I try to match the size of the Makati to the size of the hackamore or bozal, and that gives us a pretty good clean signal. If I use a bigger Makati on this 5/8, then the signal's going to get dull. There have been some times where, like, if we've got a horse that maybe this bozal is just a little bit too small, we could put a half inch Makati on it and still ride it and be okay. But for general purposes, I usually try to stick to the same.
Some people even, you know, weighing them and telling you that it's got to be exactly a certain way.
And that's something that, again, I don't know where that tradition comes from, but it certainly doesn't come from where I was raised on the coast. Because we have such a fluctuation in with all of the fog and the moisture in the air, that Makati will absorb water, and it will, in the winter, when there's a lot of fog, and in the summer when it's warm like it is here in Australia, it'll dry out. So you'll have a big fluctuation in weight just from the moisture in the air. Plus, I mean, there's a lot of times when we're working where we've got to swim the horses. And when you swim the horse and that Makati absorbs that weight, it's one of those things that it changes periodically. The other thing is, when you think about the length of rein, so if we weigh this entire Makati, well, the only part that's important is the rein length. So we're only, I mean, it's a 22-foot Makati, and we've only got that much of it that we're actually using as a signal.
So if it was a little longer and you're still using the same length, then the weight's going to change anyway.
Exactly. Yeah, if you change the rein length, then the weight changes. So.
And we've got some different materials here.
This
is one I picked up from New Zealand.
Yeah, this one's New Zealand wool. This one is mane hair. This one is tail hair. You can also find them in mohair. Is this mohair?
That's mohair.
So we've got four different Makates, all in four different materials. And three of these four are really quite good. The tail hair, I don't care for personally. It's pretty rough, although this one, the feel of the hair, usually they're very stiff, but this one's actually not too bad. Now, there are some of the old guys that said, well, they like to use these tail hair ones in the beginning because the horse can feel that on the side of their neck. But I've found that I just don't really kind of need it. However, like, some people really don't like the feel at all of any of the hair ropes. So for them, if they don't like that prickly feeling in their hand, then this mohair or like this New Zealand wool can be a good option.
So you wouldn't use anything that wasn't... You wouldn't use synthetic ropes?
Yeah, personally, I don't like synthetics on a hackamore for a couple of reasons, especially when we look at the synthetic ropes, just like these that are like the yacht rope. They're too slick. And what happens is, as you're riding and you pick up on that rein, and especially with a young horse, if they do something silly and you kind of got to get a hold of them, it will slide and it'll start to pinch down. And now it'll change the entire shape of your hackamore. These don't do that. If you are dead set on riding with nylon, I always suggest to use like the braided parachute cord as opposed to the slick yacht rope. That might be fine for snaffle bits, but for hackamores, it's no good. We do have some fluctuation. Like I said, when things get wet with these, like the horsehair will absorb water and get stiff. That's just part of the deal. I mean, it's one of those where it doesn't really dramatically affect your ability to use it as long as you adjust with your hands. And then for those people that don't like them when they're really stickery, like this one, when you ride them a lot, like this one has been ridden a lot, and this one is just as smooth as this mohair. In fact, I would argue in some ways it actually has a much better feeling than the mohair does. I mean, you're not going to get much softer than New Zealand wool.
No.
But that doesn't
have the same life in it either, does it?
The life is a little different. Yeah. Now, I have one of the New Zealand wool ones, and I really like it a lot. But one thing I haven't done is I haven't really gotten to ride it yet in really extreme temperature conditions and, you know, swimming a horse when it's, you know, super hot and then having it dry out right away. Where these horsehair ones I have quite a lot, and they've held up really well. Mm-hmm. The best feeling makata I've ever had was made of human hair. And before you freak out, don't worry. The guy that did it, his wife was a hairdresser, so he picked up the hair off the floor. That one was nice because when it got wet, it didn't really change much. Like human hair, it didn't get really stiff the way that some of the horsehair ones did.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's good.
But they're super expensive.
Okay, so you're riding in your 5/8 to start with then, I guess, for
I ride in the 5/8, and like I said, about 95% of my training is done in this.
Yeah.
I never go down in size to fix a problem. For me, I only go down to the smaller ones because everything is working really well in this. What happens is when we go down to these smaller sizes, these are placing the pressure in a smaller area.
Yeah.
So the smaller one, people go, well, the smaller one is kinder. The smaller one actually is a sharper signal.
Yeah.
Which does provide us a higher degree of refinement because I can get the same signal with the small one by doing less movement with my hand, less pressure in the rein. But if the horse is going to buck or jump sideways or do something silly like that, I don't want a sharp signal. So when it's working really good in this, then I go to this, or I go to the half inch.
I come across a lot of customers that like riding in halters or what they call a bitless bridle.
Yeah.
Really a halter with reins attached.
Yeah.
But that would be thin too, huh?
It would be thin. And the other problem with a lot of those is they don't have the consistency. When you take a look at a rope halter, it shifts around on the horse's head a lot. And you don't really have the refinement of signal. It's kind of like the difference between using a landline and a smartphone. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, you can still talk and have a conversation, but on the smartphone, you can do so much more.
Yeah.
So when I look at a lot of, I mean, and there are people who are marketing rope halters as a hackamore. It's not. Yeah. For it to be a hackamore, it has to have the rawhide core. It has to have that that movement to it. And one of the nice things is that when you put it on the horse's head, it stays there. And if it's fitted correctly, it's not too open. If it's too open, it'll bounce around. Yeah. We have problems. If it's fitted correctly, it stays there. It gives a very refined signal. And the other thing, it avoids one big problem I see with a lot of bitless bridles is that they move up too far under the jaw. Uh-huh. And they hit a nerve. There's a facial nerve that runs under that jawbone. And those halters, some of those other bitless bridles, they run into that nerve.
Yeah.
And then the horse starts to get tension in the pole. Where if this is adjusted correctly, it doesn't do that.
And the dimensions, like the nose button on that, is a lot smaller than the ones I used to see, like the
mass-produced
ones.
This one, the nose button is a little longer, which it's still within the normal range, but we can just kind of see the difference in length of the nose button. This one has a little contrast here. So it's a little bit shorter on this one.
Yeah.
If the nose button is too long, what happens is we get this teeter-totter effect.
Yeah.
And then this is bouncing up and down on the nose. What I want is with the shorter nose button, when I pick up the reins, this should just roll on the nose. It shouldn't bounce up and down because then we're going to create irritation instead of signal.
Some people seem to freak because they say, oh, it's too close to the eye. I need a way bigger nose button
to get it away from the eye. If it's too close to the eye, you can just take an extra piece of leather and just tie that back under the jaw and just kind of tie that back away from the eye. Mm-hmm. But one of the things when we're looking at where this sits in the eye is as long as it's not in the eye and it's laying behind the eye, you're okay. Yeah. It's like my glasses, these little pads right here actually sit really close to the corner of my eye, but it's no problem. I never even think about it. No. I mean, that's quite close.
Yeah.
And it's relative. It's about the same distance as most of these would sit from a horse's eye. But if it is in the eye, we need to tie it back.
That's cool. And I've got a snaffle here too, because, you know, people are...
Yeah.
I grew up with snaffles, basically, using snaffles.
It's the most common bit in the world. It's also, unfortunately, it's used to the point where everybody thinks that it's kind of the best thing around.
Yeah.
And for some horses, it's perfectly fine. But depending on the conformation of their mouth, some horses, it's horrible.
Yeah.
Last year in clinics, I ran into over 20 horses that should never be ridden in a snaffle bit because of the conformation of their mouth. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I recommend, and no matter what the trainer is, that if somebody recommends a bit to you, if they haven't looked in the horse's mouth, there's really no way to know mm-hmm. for sure if that's going to be the best tool. Traditionally, a lot of people will tell you that the California tradition is that you ride first in the snaffle bit, yeah. then you go to the hackamore, then you go to the two rein, which is the bolsel being ridden under the bridle, mm-hmm. and you have two sets of reins, the bolsel rein and the bridle rein. And then you go straight up in the bridle, which is riding in the bit, the mm-hmm. curb bit with no bolsel. That is part of the later tradition. By later tradition, I'm talking about like post-World War I kind yeah. of tradition. It started to become popular around World War I when other traditions started coming into California and people started bringing their gear with them. The true old vaquero tradition of California is first rides in a hackamore, and mm-hmm. every ride after that's in a hackamore until the horse is ready for to yeah. start introducing them to the bridle.
Yeah. And I was at Equitana recently, and I was riding with my spade,
mm-hmm.
and somebody said, oh, could you drop that and show me the bit? And I went, don't freak, you know, if I yeah. take it off. And yeah. they freaked, you know.
Yeah. People lose their mind because they don't understand how this works.
No.
They're so used to riding in a bit and pulling.
Yeah.
They don't understand the concept of not pulling on a bit. And we see that with, it doesn't matter what discipline we're talking about. The vast majority, the overwhelming majority of horsemen in the world today mm-hmm. use a bit for control. They pull, they use pressure in the yeah. bit. These old California style of bits are designed to give a signal, not to give pressure. Yeah. If we need pressure, that's why we ride with this under the bit.
Yeah.
So that we don't have to pull on this. And that's where people don't understand how no. these tools work.
I was explaining, you know, like last year you had me riding with some tail hair just joining this onto my yeah. reins.
Yeah, this is something when we look at our gear, one of the things you'll see, and like there's some of the documentaries and stuff about some of the vaquero tradition, that there's one of the guys in one of them that says the sign of a really good bridle horse is when you can tie a little piece of string between your reins and your bit mm-hmm. and not break it. That's a good bridle horse. Well, he's getting close. Mm-hmm. The tradition I was raised with is that if you ride with the bolsel under it and you've got just a few pieces of tail hair like we did with Steve last mm-hmm. year, and you can go doctor cows all day for a few days and not pick up the bolsel rein and not break the hair, then the horse is ready to even think about being a bridle horse, a straight up bridle horse, a bridle horse without yeah. the bolsel.
So you would never take that off until you got your horse to that stage.
Yeah, I would keep the bolsel on mm-hmm. until I got the horse to the stage where I could do all the work, everything I wanted in the bridle without breaking that small string or those pieces of tail hair.
Yeah.
So that wasn't, for my family, that wasn't a test of a good bridle horse. That was a test the horse is even ready to think about even going straight up in the bridle.
Yeah. yeah. It's a different belief system, I guess.
Yeah, and the tools are, when we look at this gear, everything has a purpose. There's a reason for everything that we do. And there's a lot of that that's been lost because it hasn't been written down.
Yeah.
Even like when you're looking at your bridle, these chains at the mm-hmm. bottom. A lot of people don't understand the chains because yeah. it's not written in a book anywhere.
No, some people don't use them now.
Some people don't use them. In fact, yeah. in a lot of the modern sport world, they don't use them at all. But these chains on a good bridle horse, just picking up the weight of this chain is enough to signal the horse. And when we're looking at this, yes, it does keep our nice rawhide Romal reins from getting wet when we let the horse drink when we're following cows.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody a while back told me, well, why don't you just take the bridle off? You don't have time. Mm-hmm. You've got, you know, a few seconds, let the horse drink and then move on. But the key is that this is a big part of the signaling process. And if you connect the reins directly to the bit, the signal just, again, we lose the refinement
yeah.
in the signal.
And then, you know, some people go, well, that spoon's going to hit the roof of the mouth, but that's badly adjusted. If
absolutely. This curb strap curbs the action of the spoon. There's even a video of a guy saying that the spoon touching the roof of the mouth is part of the signal.
Mm-hmm.
And I was always taught that that should never touch the roof of the mouth for good reason. Horse moves away from pressure. You put pressure in the roof of the mouth, where's your head going to go? It's going to go up.
Yeah.
So if this curb strap is adjusted properly, which on a spade bit, you adjust it a little bit tighter than you do a regular bit. So in order to put my bit on and take it off, I have to unbuckle my curb strap. When I pick this up and this curb strap goes under the chin, this can no longer rotate. It has nowhere to go.
So it just becomes a curb.
Just becomes a curb.
Yeah.
And if I pull down hard enough that I'm able to make that start to move, I've already pulled too hard.
Yeah.
I should be able to have enough sensitivity in my hands that when I pick up this bit, I feel the tongue of that horse as I pick up that bit. And then I feel that engage under the chin. As I pick up a little more, this cannon, this cross piece, will then pull down onto the bars, which is the jawbone, basically. Mm-hmm. The moment that touches that jawbone, touches those bars, I should have enough sensitivity in my hands that I know I don't go any further. I don't pull any more. And in fact, that already tells me I probably went just a little bit too far, and it's time to go back and now pick up the pressure with this to fix whatever problem it is. But most people never even practice being able to feel that tongue pressure.
Yeah.
So this bit works off of tongue pressure and works off of the movement of this bit in the corners of the mouth. This thing right here does two things for us. Gives the horse a lot more surface area to hold onto and hold it in their mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And if they're holding it, they can feel every movement. If it's just hanging there, it takes a while before that movement happens. And the other thing is that when we look at the balance of these bits, each bit has a little different balance. And the other thing that this does is this just helps that horse to find neutral on their own without us having to do anything. So they find that neutral.
Meaning the head position.
Yeah, that good head position where it's maybe just a little bit in front of vertical, mm-hmm. Relaxed in the pole. They find that on their own and we don't have to do anything. It's some of that polish.
So knowing all those angles is important too.
Very important. Knowing how your horse travels, knowing the angle of not only the balance of the bit, but even the angle of this spoon in relation to the conformation of the horse's mouth. Like with this bit and this horse, when Steve first got this bit, the angle of this spoon was not quite right for this horse. It came back just a little too much and was putting a little tongue pressure. So I...
Yeah, it scared me.
Scared him a little bit.
Yeah.
I took it to the anvil, took a hammer and started beating on it. So I took his brand new nice silver spade bit and started whacking it with a hammer. Stuck in the horse's mouth, and the horse went, yep, that's it, thank you. And it was very clear right away, totally comfortable.
But without that sort of knowledge, no, I wouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
Because
you know,
I had no idea, really.
Yeah. And it's this is part of this California tradition that has kind of been lost because a lot of this hasn't been written down. And there's so many little pieces to this.
So just running out and buying one is not a good idea.
Not a good plan at all. And in fact, really, overall, the art of bidding a horse has been lost compared to what we had, you know, during the Baroque era and the Renaissance era. But this has to be fitted for your specific horse's mouth or else you're going to run into problems.
Yeah.
The way the teeth are set can drastically change how we need these braces set, how far down this goes. Some horses, my wife's horse, for instance, his canine teeth are too high. He can't go in a spade bit. He has to go in a half breed like this because the cannon, this crossbar here, sits too low in his mouth and that tooth interferes.
Yeah.
So what do we do?
So that's why you have the different styles.
The different styles. So I took a really nice spade bit, took it into the shop, did even worse than I did to yours. I chopped the spoon off, took the braces off, turned it into a half breed. And now he loves it. No problem at all.
Yeah. So there are some people, I guess, rushing folks into one of those when it's probably not a good idea either.
Big mistake. The way I was taught was basically in my family and in the old tradition, you kind of earn the right to ride in a spade bit. You earn it either by growing up in the tradition where you're kind of tested every day, or if you can make a really good hackamore horse, then you probably have the hands to ride in one of these.
Yeah.
But if you don't have those two things, this is like giving a monkey a razor blade. I mean,
Yeah.
If you're pulling on it, then it's the wrong tool. It's absolutely the wrong tool.
So just because you're wearing it doesn't mean you have a bridle horse.
No, that's something that, just because you stick a bit in a horse's mouth doesn't make him a bridle horse.
Yeah.
And the idea of what is a bridle horse is kind of a hotly debated topic. But the way I grew up, a good bridle horse is, the good old California bridle horse is very different than most of what we see today.
Yeah.
We see some very good horses in the bridle in the show ring, and they're absolutely awesome in the show pen. but you can't take them out and work.
Yeah.
We see some horses that are really good working horses in the bridle, but you take them in the show ring and it's a train wreck.
Yeah.
A good California bridle horse, you should be able to go into a rein working cow horse show and you may not win, but you're not going to embarrass yourself. You should be able to go do a day's work anywhere in the world. But there's also that artistic quality that a good bridle horse has. And the other piece that's missing that has always been a part of the old tradition is the horse should be able to move like a bullfighting horse. And that's always been part of the old bridle horse tradition, but that's a big part that's been lost. I don't see any of the bridle horses today that move like a bullfighting horse.
You're talking correct flexion and
correct flexion, good side movements, the ability to really gallop any direction you want with any bend you want in the body. I don't see that in the modern bridle horses that people are promoting. But then a lot of times I don't see it in the dressage world either.
No.
When you look at the modern dressage horse, if you took them back to the 1600s and you went to war on those horses, you'd die quickly. like the modern bridle horses. If you took them into the bullfighting ring, same thing. Yeah. You're going to be dead really quick. So same outcome, because the training, we've lost a lot of that old foundational training.
Well, that's great.
Yeah.
Thank you for that.
All right.
So that's a lot bigger talk about gear than just expected.
And that was just scratching the surface. Yeah. We could sit here all day and do this.
So we might have a little break and then do a little bit of video on how to fit this gear on my horse.
Sounds good.
Okay.
Yeah, sounds cool. Like a plan.